We're continuing a series entitled, But God. And as we continue this series today, we want to wrestle in this space called Temptation, But God. Temptation, But God. I apologize to the praise team. I changed the message on them from what they originally received, but I'm so thankful that God works in the midst of all of it. But today we want to talk about temptation, but God. George Santayana in 1905 said this: those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. 1905. In 1948, in a speech before the House of Commons, Winston Churchill changed the quote slightly, and he paraphrased it saying this: those who fail to learn from history are condemned to repeat it. The suggestion from both of the quotes is that those who fail to learn, those who ignore, those who forget about history have the potential to repeat some of the mistakes of the past. And believe it or not, this is not an old thing or an old debate. This is actually a modern debate. As you pay attention to what's going on within America right now, some would say that we're experiencing a deja vu moment. A deja vu moment where, once again, we're dealing with some trying to rewrite laws to make it hard for people to vote. A deja vu moment where we're struggling with what part of the story do we tell? Do we tell the whole story with all of its beauty and its ugliness, or do we just tell part of the story? In an article by Olivia Waxman, she says this. She says, is our natural history merely a tool to inspire patriotism, or is it, as historians argue, a valuable lesson in the good, the bad, and the ugly? You see, the truth is that lessons from the past may not always ward off the redoing of human ugliness, but they can provide some insights that can help us in the present and even guide us towards the future. So I ask, have we been good students of history? Have we learned the lessons that can help us not make some of the same mistakes that others have made who came before us? Are we students of world history? Are we students of American history? Are we students of biblical history? And are we students of church history? Again, those who fail to learn from history are condemned to repeat it. But that's actually something that Paul understood long before Santayana and Churchill made the statement. Paul communicates this truth while writing to a group of Christians who were in Corinth. He communicates this truth in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, where he pauses for a moment as he talks to these Christians. Corinth is a strange place. It's a popular place. It's a merchant city that has a lot of people that are selling goods. It's a place where they have a whole bunch of spirituality. They have a whole bunch of gods that they worship, a number of temples that they gather at, and typically the temple worship involves some form of sexual immorality or prostitution. It's a place that they make a whole bunch of money from trade with pottery and brass. So it's a popular place where a whole bunch of people have gathered. The city of Corinth is a place that has such a bad or notorious reputation that when somebody wants to say that you're living a wild kind of lifestyle, they just say Corinthianize, to communicate that, man, if you're from there, you just foul, modern day language, right? So he's writing to these Christians in Corinth. He opened up the letter reminding them that even though they are in Corinth, that they've been called by God, that they've been selected by God through the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they've been set apart from everybody else to live different from everybody else. They've been set apart to be saints, basically to live a life that's pleasing and honoring to God. He reminds them that they have been set apart to honor God. So even though they live in a corrupt culture, that God has called them to live by a different standard. And when he writes to them in Corinth, he writes to address a number of issues. They have issues of unity within the life of the church. So modern day, they pick and choose which is their favorite preacher, and then they compare their favorite preacher with your favorite preacher, and then they evaluate you based on your favorite preacher. They have some issues with one another, not properly relating within the life of the church, not getting along with one another within the life of the church. They have some divorce stuff going on within the life of the church, some marital issues and conflict. They have some disputes going on over doctrine within the life of the church. What do they believe and how do they live out what they believe in very practical ways? They actually have debates about what should take place in worship and how that's going to take place in worship. And Paul writes to address all of this. And as he writes to address a number of these issues, reminding them of who they are, by the time we get to chapter 10, he takes a moment and he really wants to emphasize that we need to learn the lessons from the past. For if we don't learn the lessons from the past, he's specifically talking about Israel's past when they were in the wilderness. If we don't learn the lessons from their experience, then we will repeat those lessons. And I know some of you, as you get older, you probably have those conversations with some of your children and some of your grandchildren, some of your nieces and some of your nephews. You try to tell them, I've been there, I've done that. I'm telling you, it's not going to work out the way you think it's going to work out. We're basically trying to say to them, I want you to learn the lessons from the past. Because even though experience is the best teacher, it doesn't have to be your experience. It can be somebody else's experience that you learn from and grow from and be better as a result of your learning. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, as he challenges them to reflect upon the history of the nation of Israel in the wilderness, he wants them to learn the lesson that if you learn from their past, no matter what temptation comes your way, you can be victorious. Can I ask, has anybody in the room ever been tempted? Temptation is anything that occurs that causes us to trust anybody other than God. Trust anything other than God. And sometimes that means trusting ourselves and not trusting in God. He wants them to understand that if you pay attention to the history of Israel in the wilderness, this can help us, help you to be victorious over whatever temptation may come your way. So listen to how he frames it. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning at verse 1. Now, I don't want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, all passed through the sea, and all were baptized in Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them since they were struck down in the wilderness. I know some of you don't have actual Bibles that you can write in, but if you have a digital device that you're utilizing, if there's some way for you to highlight the areas where it says all, do you see that again and again in your translation? All. They all had the same experience. They all had the same experience of God's favor, of God delivering them out of Egypt. They all had the same experience of being able to operate under the cloud, which represented the presence of God that guided them by day and night. They all had the same experience of going through the Red Sea. They all had the same experience of being able to eat manna or bread from heaven. They all had the same experience of being able to drink water from a rock. They all had the same experience of God's faithfulness, of God's love, and God's kindness. They all had the same experience, and yet, he concludes, God is not pleased, was not pleased with most of them, which is actually a generous statement. Because for those of us who have been reading through the Bible, we know that God was not pleased with most of them, in the majority of them, in almost all of them, except for Joshua and Caleb. Everybody else said, we're not going into the promised land. And God says, okay, the rest of you all are going to die in the wilderness, but your children who are younger than you, they will go into the promised land. Most of them, because of their rebellion, because of their lack of faith, because of their inability to place their confidence and their trust in God, the scripture says they died in the wilderness. How is it that they can all experience God in the same way, and yet their experience of God didn't cause them to have faith in God. Listen to what the Hebrew writer says when he describes this experience in Hebrews 3 and 16. For who heard and rebelled? Wasn't it all who came out of Egypt unto Moses? With whom was God angry for 40 years? Wasn't it with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest? If not to those who disobeyed, so we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. You see, Paul is saying, man, I want you to pay attention to this lesson because what happened to the nation of Israel can happen to you. I know you're in Corinth, and I know you're dealing with some things, and I know you're wrestling with some things that may want to tempt you to not trust in God, may want to tempt you to adapt to the ways of the culture, but I want to let you know that there are consequences when we choose not to trust in God. So he lays the background, provides for them the history, and then gives specific examples beginning at verse 6. Now, these things took place as examples for us, so that we will not desire evil things as they did. Don't become idolaters as some of them were, as it is written. The people sat down to eat and drink, got up to party. Let us not commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in a single day 23,000 died. Let us not test Christ as some of them did and were destroyed by snakes, and don't grumble as some of them did and were killed by the destroyer. What Paul does is he brings up actual examples in the life and the journey of the nation of Israel. And as he brings up actual examples, he alludes to the larger story. He tells a part of the story, right? So worshiping idolatry, when Moses is up on the mountain in Exodus chapter 32, and they decide, Moses taking too long, so we're going to make a God in our own image and our own likeness. So they make the golden calf, and they worship the golden calf, and they say, this is the God that brought us out. What Paul does is he points to specific moments in time, specific incidents in the life and history of Israel to say, here is what they did. Instead of waiting and just trusting God, they again and again chose not to trust God. And he uses these examples to try to help those who are in Corinth, that these examples are for you to learn from. This history that I'm telling you is a gift to you so that your eyes might be open so that you won't make the same mistake that they made. Well, to make it practical, someone has said as it relates to experiences and things of life, to never say never. Anybody else heard that? When I was growing up, the old people say, never say never. They said, never say never. Why? Because you don't know what life will bring your way. And because you don't know what life will bring your way, you don't know how you'll respond when life brings it your way. The things you think you'll be able to withstand and take and bounce back from and things of that nature, you don't know how you're going to respond. You don't know how it's going to hit you. And you don't know how it will impact and change you. So the old folk, you say never, because life has a way of teaching you about you. You see, so he gives this big warning in verse 12. So whoever thinks he stands must be careful lest he or she falls. You see, here's the whole idea. Paul says none of us are as strong as we think we are. None of us have as much power, as much strength, as much intellect, as much ability to overcome the things that life will throw our way. None of us, if we place our confidence in ourselves, he says, be careful when you become too self-confident, too arrogant, too prideful. When we overestimate our ability and underestimate our humanity, we are making a mistake. It's said this way in one of the Proverbs, simply pride comes before a fall. That's how it's simply stated. So after giving the warning, Paul shares a few things that are helpful for the Corinthians. to help them relate to, man, how does this apply to temptation? And for some of you, you're like, man, I've been waiting on you to get to this thing that I can apply, that I can use, that I can take. How does this apply to temptation? So he concludes in verse 13. Listen to what he says, and we'll spend the rest of our time here. No temptation has come upon you except what is common to humanity. But God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. I only have 3 points to make. Here is the first one. Every temptation we face is common. Every temptation we face is common. Here's what that basically means, that every temptation we face or no temptation that any of us face is unique to us. If you are a human being, there are certain things that are just going to come your way. And when that thing comes your way, that causes you to question, am I going to trust God or am I going to do me? Am I going to trust God and trust what God has said, or am I going to go with what everybody else said? That thing that comes your way that you think it only came to you and nobody else has ever dealt with anything like that before but you. He says, nah, it's common. He says, this is a part of the human experience. Temptations and trials are a part of the human experience. So when that temptation comes, please know that it's common. When we are tested, please know that it is common. I appreciate John, who says this in 1 John 2. He says, don't love the world's ways. Don't love the world's goods. Love of the world squeezes out love for the Father. Practically everything that goes on in the world, wanting our own way, wanting everything for yourself, wanting to appear important, has nothing to do with the Father. It just isolates you from him. The world and all its wanting message translation is on the way out. But whoever does what God wants is set for eternity. He says there are some temptations that are just common, wanting our own way. Other translations say the lust of the flesh, really being able to make the choice that we want to act independently of God. The same thing that we see in the beginning in the garden, where they want to act independently of God, where we want to do us, we want to do our thing, we want to do it our way. We don't want to listen to God, we don't want to regard God. God, this is my life, I can live it the way I want to live it. He says that's a temptation that's common to humanity. Wanting everything for ourselves, the lust of the eyes, selfishness. He says that's a temptation that's common to humanity. Wanting to appear important, or pride of life. Wanting to be valued and appreciated based on worldly values instead of what's important in the eyesight of God. He says that's common. These are great temptations for all of us, whether you are 6 or 96. I laugh sometimes when I talk to people who are a little bit more mature, and I try to be as nice and as gracious as I can, but sometimes I'm stubborn, and sometimes I lean in maybe when I shouldn't lean in. But again, I try to respond to my elders as though they're elders, but sometimes I talk to them, and they talk like, you know, I don't have to deal with stuff like that anymore at my age. I'm like, who you fooling? Who you think you fooling? I don't have to worry about stuff like that no more at my age. Like, who you think you fooling, right? It's common. You deal with the same stuff just like everybody else. Now, there are some things you may not deal with as much, but they are common. The question becomes, since these things are common, how do we respond? It encourages me to know that whatever comes my way as a test, as a trial, as a temptation, it's common. I'm not the only one. Other people have dealt with it before. Other people are going to deal with it after me. Other people are going to have to deal with it probably the same week as me. But it's common. It's a normative experience. Second thing, no temptation we face is greater than God's ability to help us overcome it. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Listen to what the scripture says. But God is faithful. God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. God is faithful. God can be counted on. God can be trusted. God comes through. God shows up. God is reliable. God is faithful. And I'm thankful that God's faithfulness to his people is not based on the faithfulness of his people, but it's based on a faithful God. Because there are times again and again when God remains faithful even when we are faithless. But because God is a faithful God, God continues to be faithful. And God demonstrates his faithfulness by coming to our rescue to provide us what we need. God's ability to provide is greater than the temptation we face. So hear me when I say this. I've heard it said. I think I've said it myself. And I've heard other people say it. That God won't put more on you than you can bear. If by that statement, we mean that God won't allow situations in our life beyond our ability to handle them on our own, I totally disagree. If when we say God won't put more on you than you can bear, we mean that God won't put more on you than in your own ability and your own strength you can handle, I totally disagree. But my opinion is not important. I think Paul would agree in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Listen to what Paul says. We don't want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, of our affliction that took place in Asia. We were completely overwhelmed beyond our strength so that we even despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death so that we would not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a terrible death, and he will deliver us. We have put our hope in him that he will deliver us again. Paul says, man, we were in a situation where we were overwhelmed. It was beyond our ability, but our trust is not in ourselves. Our trust is in God. And then in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul says, for if I want to boast, I wouldn't be a fool because I would be telling you the truth, but I will spare you so that no one can credit me with something beyond what he sees in me or hears from me, especially because of the extraordinary revelations. Therefore, so that I would not exalt myself, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to torment me, so that I would not exalt myself. Concerning this, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness. Therefore, I will most gladly boast all the more about my weakness so that Christ's power may reside in me. So I take pleasure in weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and in difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. You see, God is faithful. God will not allow us to deal with something that we are not able as we lean and depend upon him, as we turn to him. God supplies the grace that we need, the strength that we need, the power that we need. It's in our weakness that we see his strength and see his greatness and see his power. Paul says, I want you to hear that, man, what we have to do is learn to lean into God. The point is not that the temptation won't be more than our power to overcome, but that the temptation won't be greater than God's power to help us overcome it. So with every temptation we face, we need to step back and remind ourselves that if God allowed this to come to me, God will give me what I need to go through it. And this is my last point, and this one messed with me, so I don't know how you'll hear it. Last point is that God provides a way out in every temptation. But hear the text. No temptation has come upon you except what is common to humanity, but God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to bear it. Did you hear it? Hear it again. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to bear it. Here. God's going to provide a way out so that you may be able to bear it. You hear it? He's going to provide a way out so that you may be able to bear. Wait. So my understanding, right, was God, because you are faithful, that you're going to provide a way out. which means you take me out, which means I don't have to bear because I'm out. But that's not what it says. It doesn't say he's going to provide a way out and I'm out and don't have to bear it. No, he says he's going to provide a way out so that I may be able to bear it. I'm like, whoa. You see, here is what's happening. The stretch of our faith muscles grow when we're in the midst of testing and trials, and we learn to lean and depend upon God. And God, in the midst of the situation, provides us what we need so that we can go through the situation. And the way out is through. I know I didn't like it either when I heard it. Because I want out to be out. I want out to be, you stopped it, you shut it down, you closed it. But God said, no, I'm going to give you what you need so that you can go through this thing, so that as you lean and depend upon me while going through this thing, your faith muscles will grow like never before. So the next time you got to go through something, you'll reflect back upon this situation and know that if I brought you through this, I'll take you through that, because your muscles grew in the midst of the experience. What Paul wants us to understand is that the tension of temptation and trials and tests, when we lean into God, help us to grow in our faith. Paul's encouragement to the believers in Corinth is that they can be successful where Israel failed if they learn the lesson from history and make the choice to trust God. The encouragement for us is that no matter what temptation we may face, what I love about the text is that Paul doesn't tell us what temptation Corinthian is dealing with. He doesn't tell us what they're facing as a group of people. I mean, we can imagine there's a whole lot. I mean, we hear discussions about, do we go to the temple or not? Do we eat meat offered from the temple or not? We hear a whole bunch of discussions where they are tempted by the culture that they're living in, but he doesn't tell us specifically. And I love that it's general, because it's a great reminder that no matter what our test, no matter what our temptation, that if we remember God is faithful, that the way out is through. Because he wants to remind them that the same God that set you apart in Christ, that called you as saints because of Christ, the same God that in every place he says you call upon the name of Jesus Christ as your Lord, that same God will bring you through no matter what the test or the temptation. As the people of God, my prayer is that we would trust in God, that we would learn the lessons from the past. And if you've lived long enough, you can learn the lessons from your past. You don't have to look at Israel's past. You don't even have to look outside your house to look at somebody else's past. You can learn the lessons from your past and look at times when you chose not to trust God and how it turned out. And when you chose to trust God and how it turned out, the key is us learning to lean and depend upon him. I close with this. As I was reflecting upon Israel's example, I was reminded that the nation of Israel during this time in the traveling of the wilderness, they were positioned in such a way that the tent of the meeting, the place that represented God's presence, was in the middle. So as a nation of people, they are around, but the tent of the meeting, the place where they worship, the place where they celebrate God, the place where they acknowledge God, is in the middle. It's in the center of the nation of Israel, as a reminder that all you got to do is keep God at the center. It was literally in the center, but the reminder for us, because we don't have a literal place where God is in the center, a reminder for us in our relationship with Jesus Christ is keep Jesus at the center of our lives. To make sure that he is the one who is in control, that he is the one who is in charge, to make sure that he is the one who is dominating our thoughts and guiding us in every situation and every circumstance, that we don't look anywhere else, but we say we want to look to you, Jesus, first. And as we look to you, we can trust and depend that all that we need to make it through whatever temptation we're facing, you will provide. So this morning, as we prepare to pray, what's your temptation? In the discussion guide that's given, we raise the question, what are some of the temptations that you're facing? And I know you may not want to post them online and tell anybody in the room, but can we at least be honest with God? To say, God, in this space, I've been tempted not to trust you, but to trust what this person has to say, not to trust your word, not to lean and depend upon your guidance, but to look somewhere else. In this situation, I've been, God, tempted to lean and depend upon my knowledge and my independence. God, in this situation, God, my pride has risen up. I haven't humbled myself, and that's me trusting in me. Whatever the situation is, can you bring it before God and say, God, help me to learn the lessons from the past and give me victory in the midst of this temptation so that I can honor you. So for those who are online and those who are in person, take a moment. And as you bow before God, as you go before God, let's take this temptation to God and to say to him, God, here's my request. I want to ask you not only to supply what I need, but I want to ask you to help me, no matter what happens, no matter what comes my way, to have a resolve that I'm going to keep Jesus at the center. That the Jesus who died for me and rose for me, who's seated at the right hand of the Father interceding for me, that I'll look to him, that I'll keep my eyes on him. Because he is the author and he is the finisher of my faith. So God, help me to be able to look to him. So Father, as we pray today, some online, some in person, you know the specifics. You know the details. You know the challenges we face that nobody else knows, oftentimes because we won't tell anybody else. But because you know, we're asking, since you know it's common, that you would give us what we need, that you would supply the strength, that you would supply the grace, that you would supply the wisdom, that you would supply the insight, so that we might be able to overcome, so that we won't give in, so that we won't fall. Help us, God, not to trust in ourselves, but instead to place our trust, our hope, and our confidence in Jesus the Christ. And for those who may not have yet trusted in Jesus, don't yet understand if they want to trust in Jesus, we pray that they would be open to investigating him, that they would be open to discovering why he came and what he did for humanity and how he can make a difference in their lives. And we look forward to the opportunity to being able to connect with them and answer some questions and dialogue and wrestle as we grow together. We're all on a journey. So we thank you, God, that in the midst of the journey, you are with us. So help us now, those of us who may be online, those of us who are in person, our eyes are on you. Jesus, our heart's desire is that you would be at the center. So as we prepare to worship you today, we pray that you would continue to speak. We pray that you would continue to minister. Most importantly, we pray that you would draw us closer to you so that we might sense your strength and your power. Hear our prayer now. In Jesus' name.